Hello, thanks for watching. I'm Todd Baginski. I'm a Microsoft MVP and the partner and CTO at Canvas Consulting. In this video, I'm going to take you on a deep dive of the Book a Room Power Apps sample template. I'm going to show you how to find available meeting rooms and their associated email addresses in a Power App. To demonstrate this concept, I'm going to use the Book a Room Power Apps sample template. Before I dive into the code, I'm actually going to show you what this looks like in the user interface so you get a picture of really the use case we're trying to solve here before we look at the code. So the first thing I'm going to do is pick Book for an existing meeting. And that's going to pull back the meetings that I have on my calendar today. As you can see, I have three different meetings in my calendar, and one of them doesn't have a location. The Record Power Apps Deep Dive video calendar invite doesn't. And it is just, as you can see here, a Skype meeting or an online meeting. So I'm going to click that meeting right there, and I would like to actually reserve a conference room to go record those videos in. So now I can see at the today from 3 to 5 p.m. when that meeting is scheduled, here I have availability of four different conference rooms in my organization, which I can then book. This is what I'm going to show you how to determine in the meeting. How did I return these four meeting rooms were available at this time on this date? To see how that's done, I'm going to put the Power App back into edit mode in the editor and take it out of preview mode. Now, the pattern I'm about to show you about really how to reverse engineer these Power Apps can be one that you can use to learn about any of these Power App sample templates. Essentially, as you saw, I navigated to the screen inside of the app while I had the editor open and I was running in preview mode. Once I got to the screen where I saw the functionality I was interested in, then I closed the preview mode and I returned to edit mode. Now I'm able to click on controls in here and learn more about them now that they're fully populated with the data. I'm first going to select on the Rooms gallery. You can see this particular control here on the left in the control tree. The Rooms gallery has its items property set to a collection named Available Room Email Name. If we click the File menu and we look for Available Room Email Name in the collection, we can find that right here in the list. This is actually what is bound to the gallery. Notice I have the name of the conference room, as well as its email address that I would need under the hood in order to book a meeting with it. This is eventually what we're shooting to get to, is this collection, so we can bind it up to the user interface. All right, so now let's dig in deep and see where this actual collection came from. If we look at the OnVisible event here, we can see that the Available Room Email Name collection at the very bottom is assembled. But where did that really come from to begin with? Well, we have to go all the way up to the top here to see where we start pulling in rooms for this particular Power App to see how the story unfolds. The Show Loading context variable here is used to show the loading screen while we're fetching new meetings. Date Time Room Change is a variable that's set if the date or the time on the left side of the screen that you can see right here are changed. No Rooms List variable is set in the OnStart method of the landing screen. If we bounce over to this one, we can see where that variable is set right there. Notice the very first line of code that executes in this app is a clear collect statement that is going to create the Rooms List collection. Here we call the Office 365 Get Rooms List Connector function. Then we check to see if the value is less than or equal to 1. If it is, we will set Rooms List to true, and then we will call Office 365.getRooms, and we will set No Rooms List to false. This ensures that we are returning rooms from the Office 365 connectors. You can look to see the difference between these two different functions to learn more about them. Essentially, by following this pattern, we guarantee that we will return all the rooms registered in Outlook for this organization. Now we can understand how we set the no rooms list property. If that property is false, then we are going to create the all rooms collection again by calling office365.getRoomsInRoomList and passing in this chosen location.address. You may be wondering where this piece comes from. There's another way to book a room and locate a room in this particular app. It happens in the room list select screen here. If we type in a value for a room here and click the search button, we can see the rooms available that match it in the org. When we pick one of those rooms, then we have the chosen location that we will set for that particular room. You can see that once items are returned in here, whenever we click it with the on select, we set the chosen location to the selected item in that gallery. That's how we populate the value inside of this particular screen where we have the chosen location address. So this is just a check to make sure that depending on whichever screen we come into this screen from inside of the app, that we're building up the collection of rooms inside of this page accordingly. After we've built the all rooms collection, we're then going to count them up and see if they're greater than 20. If they are greater than 20, what we're going to do is we're going to concatenate the first 20 rooms in that list and create a semicolon delimited list, and we're going to call this our all rooms connector. If that value of how many rooms we have is not greater than 20, then we're going to concatenate all of them, not just the first 20 here. The reason we do this is we only want to show up to 20 rooms at a time, so we don't overwhelm the user back here in the user interface with too many to choose from. Now that we have the all rooms available, let's take a look and actually see what that looks like as we dig into our collection. Here we can see all rooms. All rooms have this address as well as the name inside of the collection. The next thing we need to do is to determine, out of all the rooms that we've pulled back in the organization, which one are available at this time. So we're going to use another clear collect function here to create a new collection called available rooms. Here's when we call out to the Office 365 Outlook connector and we call the find meeting times function within that connector. Remember how we built the collection called all rooms connector of the different rooms we want to see when they're available? We're going to pass that in right here as part of the required attendees parameter. So essentially we're saying we want to find all the meeting times for all the rooms on that page that start at the start time the user specified and end at the end time. These start times and end times are set when the user selects the date and the time right here. We will also pass in the meeting duration. The meeting duration is calculated from the time value inside of the form. We also use the minimum attendee percentage of 1. This means 100%. In other words, what we're doing is we're telling this method in the connector that all of these rooms from the start to the end for this amount of time have to be 100% available for us to show them in the list that appears on this page. Now that we have the available rooms returned, let's go take a look and see what they look like. Digging back into our collection, we can click on available rooms, and here you can see it is a nested collection. And we can dig into the location, for example, and find out that we have these different locations available for all the different meeting times that we have in our calendar. There's more data in that collection as well that you can explore. The next step is to sort that available rooms collection right here by the confidence descending. This puts the rooms at the top of the list that have the highest availability for that particular time and date slot that the user has requested. Now we can take a look at the available rooms sorted collection and see what that looks like here. We can come down in and look at all the different ones, and we can see that these are the four different rooms that we have. It's a nested collection, so it takes a while to dig in. So here we can see the Beaver Creek Conference Room, but if we go back up a couple levels, now we can dig into the next one and see this is the Eagles Conference Room. We've got a lot of data, as we saw in that sorted collection. Too much data that we don't want to go through it and try to bind it up to the gallery. We want to make it easier to work with before we get it to the point where it's in this one we actually bind to our gallery. So the next step is we first are going to go through the available rooms sorted by attendee availability, where the availability is free. Then we're going to filter on those values and concatenate all them together by their email address and put them separated with a comma. So now as we dig into available rooms concat, we can see in the collections here, now we have a concatenated list of all the email addresses associated with the rooms available. The next step is to return the email addresses. Now we're going to split apart the concatenated ones and create a collection so they're not just one row, comma separated, but all different rows for each room. So if we look at available email rooms now in our collection, here we can see now they are split into four rows. This is great because we can bind four rows to our gallery very easily. Now we've got all the way down to here. We are only one step away now from getting to the available room email name collection. What we're going to do is we're going to add columns and we're going to rename columns inside of available rooms emails. Here, we're going to say our source column, our source collection is available rooms emails, and we're going to take the result column and rename it to email. Then we're going to add the column, as you can see to the top here, the name column to it. And what we're going to add to it is a lookup from the all rooms collection we started of, where that email is equal to the address. And then we're going to grab the name there. When we're done doing that, now we're at the available room email collection that we wanted to get to. And now we can see we have the email address as well as the name of each room for all of the rooms that are available in the organization at this time and date. It's quite a little dance we go through. And the reason we need to do that is because, as you saw, the data we get back from Find Meeting Times is a very heavily nested data structure. And in order for us to display that very easily within the gallery, we want to get it to the point where we just have the data in this collection at the end that we bind to the gallery. Now that we have that data back, we can actually click again on the gallery here and see, again, that is the collection we've bound to it. So how do we actually display the data here? Well, that's very simple. Clicking on the layout here will bring up the data pane. And here we can see inside of it that the only value we're really showing is the name. So that's the name column for the particular item in the gallery. As you can see, it was really easy to actually invoke the connectors to get the data back to tell us which rooms were available at this time. Most of our work was done just taking the data structure and putting it into a simpler one that we can then bind up to the user interface. We hope that this comes in handy for you as you write your own power apps that try to find available meeting rooms in your organization. And we look forward to hearing how you extend or use this template as well. Thanks for watching the video. I'll see you next time.